Good evening. Good evening. I'm Jennifer Rabb and have the extraordinary privilege of being the president of the phenomenal Hunter College, and to have the pleasure tonight on behalf of myself and where's our Jonathan Fanton, leader of Roosevelt House, one very brave man, to welcome you to Roosevelt House, our friend Harold Holzer, for tonight's interview with Rebecca Traister about her new bestseller, All the Single Ladies, Unmarried Women and the Rise of an Independent Nation. Rebecca is an author, journalist, and unapologetic feminist. In that, she is a lot like the extraordinary woman who used to live in this house. Roosevelt House was Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt's New York home for a quarter of a century till they finally moved to a bigger place, the White House. While obviously Eleanor was not a single lady, she might have wished she was at times. This house was given to her and her husband Franklin as a wedding present from his mother. There was just one caveat. Sarah, the mom, kept this half for herself. We like to call it the first New Deal. Eleanor said, "I never knew where I would see Sarah day or night." If any of you think you have mother-in-law problems, think again. Fortunately, this house became the very seat of female empowerment. It was in this house that Eleanor began her career as a public person, where she learned to overcome her shyness and emerge as an FDR surrogate in New York and in national politics. These are the rooms where she found her voice as a fearless social activist. One opinion she voiced when her husband was president was that the United States should have a woman cabinet secretary. And so, at Eleanor's direction, during the 1932 presidential transition, FDR invited his New York State Labor Secretary, Frances Perkins, to this house. And it was in the library upstairs that Frances Perkins met with FDR and agreed to become the first woman cabinet officer in US history, in return for his agreement to support her agenda of initiatives that included the 40-hour work week, minimum wage, the abolition of child labor, and an old age insurance program we now know as Social Security. It is interesting to look back on that historic meeting, thinking about Perkins' demands on one hand, knowing that FDR was under great pressure from the unions to choose one of their own as labor secretary rather than her, and knowing that the old guard would be absolutely furious about his bringing a woman into the men's club known as the United States Cabinet. So why did Franklin Roosevelt make such a bold choice? One part of the answer, maybe the biggest part, is that Perkins had a powerful inside ally, Eleanor Roosevelt, one of her most determined advocates. Our nation was truly blessed to have Eleanor Roosevelt and Frances Perkins emerge as leaders during such a critical time in our history. They shared so many aspirations, they were both so courageous, and they were both so dedicated to making the lives of working people better. Eleanor was more the idealistic public figure, and Frances the more practical insider. But taken together, they were a dream team, and our nation is a very different and better place because of them. It all happened in these rooms, and it happened thanks to a transformative force almost unmentioned in the history books, women's friendship. Rebecca writes about the enormous power of female friendship in her book. So how perfect tonight to have a room full of powerful women as her audience. I know that if Eleanor and Frances were with us, they'd be smiling. And what better place to celebrate what women can do, alone and together, than Hunter College. Hunter was founded as a women's school. Thomas Hunter believed that young women to be better teachers deserved a serious education. So in 1870, he created only the 9th school in the United States of America to allow women into higher education, women of every color, creed, and social background. We have since grown into a vast college offering all subjects and even allowing men since the 1950s. But from the start, we have welcomed and nurtured the women who make history, women like the incredible Bella Abzug, who is known for saying, "A woman's place is in the House and in the Senate." And Pauli Murray, the civil rights activist, getting so much attention now that Yale has named one of its residential colleges for her, but who is a Hunter girl first. And by the way, Pauli was also a great friend of Eleanor Roosevelt's for over 25 years and helped open her eyes to racism. Hunter is also the college of Judith Vladek, who went on to become one of the first anti-discrimination lawyers. Visionary battles she ran helped to support the idea behind Title IX. the federal law that discriminates, that prohibits discrimination on the basis of sex, which was actually ratified on this very day, June 23rd in 1972. As you can see, for almost 150 years, women have been finding their voices here at Hunter, which is why they say you could always tell a Hunter girl, but you can't tell her much. Of course, Rebecca, you can tell us something, or we wouldn't be here for tonight's interview. Rebecca has written smart, provocative essays for almost every publication you've ever subscribed to, The Nation, The New Republic, The New York Times. She is a contributor at Elle and a writer at large for New York Magazine. Maybe you saw her cover story on Hillary about a week ago. Her first book, Big Girls Don't Cry, was an award-winning look at the 2008 election. But it's her new, wildly popular book that we're going to hear about tonight, a book about that much distrusted and disparaged group, single women. Single women not only make history, they change it. And Rebecca will tell us why and how. Interviewing her is Lenore Scanese, another great voice for women and kids. Lenore came to fame when she let her 9-year-old ride the subway alone and wrote a column about it. Dubbed America's Worst Mom, she fought back by founding the book, blog, and movement, Free Range Kids. She's fighting for the same thing as Rebecca, less condescension and more freedom. Ladies, thank you so much for being with us.
Jennifer, and I am absolutely thrilled to be here with you today. I love your book.
Thank you.
The pages are all marked up. There's so many fascinating anecdotes, and it's so funny.
Oh.
It's so funny to be able to romp through history, and often an annoying history it was, and still be able to enjoy it. I love your writing.
Thank you so much.
But let's start with the biggie. You say that the history of America is sort of the history of single women.
Yes, which I did not know when I set out to write the book. I should say this, that this book took me about over 5 years to write.
Wow.
And when I set out to write it, I thought it was just going to be about contemporary single women. Because as a journalist who covers politics, but also culture, feminism, entertainment, the media from a feminist perspective, I'd been reporting for years on the plummeting rates of marriage and the rising numbers of single women, especially in cities. And I had this feeling that this was altering the nation in really serious political, social ways. And I knew how I felt it was altering it, that if you had a rise in the population of unmarried women, you had the normalization of children being born outside of marriage, of liberated sex lives outside of marriage, women as earners, that you were changing the definition of family, that you were remapping what a female adulthood was expected to entail and when and how and under what circumstances. And so I sold this book to my publisher, thinking that it was going to be a book of contemporary journalism, looking at this explosion in the population of unmarried and late married women that really began to happen in the 1990s. And I did not, I made a nod to history,
mm-hmm.
which I assumed probably entailed the Salem witch trials. I mean, honestly, that was my, in my proposal. And then I got the book contract, wonderful, we're going to have, and I think that the publisher assumed, I wanted to write a lot about how singlehood differs across race, across class, in different religious communities, different geographic communities around the United States. And then I began to do some research into the history, just to, you know, what did people used to call single women in other eras?
Was it always spinsters or spinsters old maids?
And thornbacks. Thornbacks was in the colonial United States. If you were a spinster, spinster actually derived in the Middle Ages in Europe, and it was literally a word referring to spinners, women, widows and orphans often of the Crusades, who earned without husbands, had to earn their own money and did so by spinning textiles. Mm-hmm. In the New World, it took on a meaning, which was a woman who was unmarried until she was 23. After 23, or perhaps it was after 26, I gotta get the cut, you became a thornback, which was the name of a spiny sea skate.
Plant?
Yeah,
what?
No, a sea skate, like a...
Like a fish?
A skate. Yeah, like a fish, yes, a spiny fish, the thornback.
That you wouldn't want to go to bed with.
Yeah, no, it was not a compliment. So, but I thought I was just looking that stuff up. And what I found, and I'd been going around crowing about how, oh, it's unprecedented, women have, you've never seen the marriage rate change like this. And what I learned as soon as I cracked a couple of
books,
really good history books, was that there was this remarkable precedent for it in the United States. That there had been a period in at the end, the middle to the end of the 19th century, when so many men had moved west, exploring new territory, and so many had died in the Civil War, that there was a shortage of husbands on the East Coast, and women stopped marrying. And in this case, it was particularly middle-class white women who stopped marrying in the biggest numbers. And a lot of those women, suddenly, with their adult lives, unencumbered by the enormous responsibilities of wifeliness and maternity, but also still guided by the notion that they were to be of service to God, to community, threw themselves into some of the social movements of their era. But those social movements were the incredibly disruptive social movements of their era, including the abolition movement, the suffrage movement, the labor movement, the settlement house movement. Ah. And a lot of these adult women whose adult lives, whose time and energy could be spent doing something other than raising the many children and tending to the husbands, really were part of the, and became the engines behind a lot of these movements that wound up fundamentally changing circumstances for all kinds of Americans in the late 19th and early 20th century. And so I started to trace that history. And then, you know, it only got more complicated. I don't need to take us through the whole 20th century, though I'm happy to. But
take us back through the 19th century. The thing that amazed me most was that there were so many single women in the abolition movement, mm-hmm. that women were accused of joining it just so that they could liberate black men to marry them.
To marry them, yes. And those accusations, so pervasive was the idea that abolitionists and suffragists were uh-huh. unmarried and therefore undesirable, that often even the married abolitionists were accused of being single hermaphrodites, you know,
wow.
and of pursuing that goal. Yeah. People were also, lots of the activists in those movements were also, even if they weren't unmarried for their entire lives, they became activists in a period when they were single and had somewhat more unconventional marriages or later marriages, mm-hmm. And sort of built their careers in activism. Ida B. Wells is a great example of this. Ida B. Wells was a really important anti-lynching activist and was also active in suffrage, and she married late. And in fact, her friend and colleague, Susan B. Anthony, was so pissed off that she got married that Ida B. Wells writes in her memoir of how after she got married, Susan B. Anthony would only hiss at her and call her Mrs. Barnett. And I mean, that was like the notion that she had married, and Anthony accused her of, your activism has ceased since you've been married.
No,
she had children.
Yeah.
And she did, I mean, she'd been touring Europe. She was an incredibly important figure internationally. And she married and had children, and yes, did take time out to have children.
Mm-hmm.
But then she was back. I mean, she was right. back working alongside Susan
that's
B. Anthony.
Just, that's you, isn't yeah. it? I think Rebecca was vaguely famous once for, you were on TV and you had your child.
I was
with
on
you.
TV with my child once, yes.
Child at the breast.
Right. She was not nursing until, I hasten to add, I was actually trying to get out of being on TV. I was at a, I had a new baby and I was covering the Emily's List convention in Washington, and I had gone because it was going into this election season, and I had this new baby, but I didn't want to miss it, and so I took the baby, and MSNBC asked me to be on television, and I was actually trying to get out of it by saying, I'm sorry, I'm in Washington. They said, oh, great, we have our camera there, and I said, I'm sorry, I have my little baby here, and they're like, that's fine, you can bring the baby on television. I was like, oh. So I had her in a Bjorn, and she was asleep. And I did this TV hit, but unfortunately, because it was in the Bjorn, it looked, I feel...
I thought that you were.
But it looked as though I was nursing on television. I was not. I was not.
But you would have.
No. I probably would not have nursed on television, let me be honest. But, wow. You know, I support anybody else who wants to nurse on television.
Right. Not. There's a whole room full here.
Yeah.
We were talking about the women who were single because all the guys either left or died. Are they less activists or more activists than the ones who choose not to marry? Because, like, Susan B. Anthony sounds like she was...
It's very hard to pick apart when mm-hmm. you look, especially looking historically, although it's true now, too, because this is one of the questions I get about single women now or late married women now. How much of this is active choice versus how much of it is the absorption of cultural messages? How much of it is who's available
or
not available?
Yeah, not finding a nice
guy. You know, so I often in the book talk about people who are single by choice or by circumstance. And it's quite hard in the 19th century to pick apart the strands of who. There was an active anti-marriage dialogue happening in the media, in public. You'd be surprised if you go back. I was shocked. Obviously, when I started this project, I did not know this history. When I went back and read the back and forths in the press, there were lots of women who were objecting to the social and legal constraints of marriage in the 19th century.
Because they were so terrible back then, right?
It was
terrible. You didn't have your property or anything?
No, and that, a lot of it continued right up through into the 20th century. But there was a lot of marriage law was drawn from European common law, and there was a practice of coverture so that when a man and a woman married, the woman's identity was basically subsumed into the man's identity. So her money belonged to him, any property she had was transferred to him. The man and the woman were one, and that won the man. So there were periods, in fact, where women couldn't testify against husbands, or because they were presumed to be the same person as their husband from a legal perspective. But as a reminder, it was only in 1974 that the Equal Credit Opportunity Act made it so that married women could get their own mortgages and credit cards. So it's not as though, up until 1974, if you were a married woman, you had to have your husband's signature in order to get your own line of credit. So it's not as though all of this is like ancient history. And marital rape was legal.
Don't look at me.
Sorry.
I wasn't defending it.
Right? No, but marital rape, I mean, the idea that a husband such full possession of his wife's body that he could rape her and it was not a crime, those laws didn't start getting corrected until the 1970s. And every once in a while, you still see a stray one now that, you know, a state is deciding that marital rape is illegal. So there are remnants of this that have really persisted for a very long time. But in the 19th century, especially, when you also had, women had little to no ability to control their own reproduction, either through birth control or abortion. In fact, the Comstock laws made it illegal to distribute information about...
Right, couldn't even put it through the mail.
About birth control. And so you had, and of course, medicine was not particularly advanced. So you had a lot of women, the really life and death realities of childbearing. There were women who had multiple pregnancies. Margaret Sanger, who wound up founding what is now Planned Parenthood, I believe that her mother had had 18 pregnancies and died at 52 of cervical cancer. You know, it was just, women's bodies were ravaged. And because they were, they didn't exert control over it. So a lot of the discourse in the press was about the toll that it took on them physically. It was a real risk. But women were also economically dependent on men because women could not earn at the same rate, because careers were closed to them, because education was not available to them.
Except here.
Right. Well, and what was the year? So that's exactly the point. This is the point where you have a population of women who are not married, and it's in the 1860s and 1870s that women's education begins, that opportunities begin to expand, that women's colleges begin to open, and eventually move across the country. And that's not coincidental. I mean, this is a lot of the founders of women's institutions and of historically black colleges are unmarried women, often working in partnership with each other. When there wasn't ample opportunity for advanced education, for careers, if you did wind up in a career, it was often teaching and nursing, which expanded a lot in the mid to late 19th century, but where wages were extremely low. There just wasn't much chance of remuneration that was going to keep you stable. So you were dependent on a man. And if you didn't get married, you were quite likely dependent on a father, a brother, a brother-in-law, because you had to have some connection to somebody who was an earner. Pretty much the only economic stability available to women was if they had been married to someone wealthy and were then widowed and got that money. Otherwise, there was very little chance of economic stability. If you wanted to have a socially sanctioned sex life, it was you had to be married. If you wanted to have a family, you had to do so with a husband. So there were all of these forces combining to
create get married.
married and early yeah. marriage, because it had to, it was the validating and organizing institution of female adulthood, and so it had to happen sort of at the beginning of your adulthood.
Right, and I thought one of the poignant parts in your book was actually at the very beginning when you talked about, as a kid, you were growing up reading all these girl books, and they all ended with the character getting married. It was like, that was it, no more fun.
Right, right, and they said, and they say that in the books, actually. It's interesting, now that I have a five-year-old daughter and I've been reading a lot of these books, so I write about how I was always depressed at the end of, like, I read Laura and Mary, Anne of Green Gables, Little Women,
House,
and it all
Little House on the Prairie.
Little House on the Prairie, yeah, Laura and Mary. That's how I refer to it in our house. Laura, and we want to read Laura and Mary, and they all end with the heroine eventually marrying, and it's supposed to be happy. Mm-hmm. But I was always terribly sad. Now
that's so amazing. I mean, look at how what a straight through line in your life.
Well, but fascinatingly, I now know. Because I've been reading, for example, Little House on the Prairie to my daughter, and the book was done and published, and I'd written about how depressed I was and how could I have been so depressed that Laura Ingalls winds up marrying Almanzo Wilder, and I'm reading, you know, the third or fourth book in the series, and there's a scene where she and her cousin go riding out across the prairie, and they go to visit, they're delivering wash or something, and there's a woman who looks very tired and very sad, and she says, my girl's gotten married, her daughter's gone off and gotten married, and the daughter's only 13. And Laura and her cousin ride back and have a conversation in which they are horrified by this, and in which they say, I don't want that to happen, I'm too young, I want to keep having fun, and they talk about marriage as a terrible fate that has befallen this poor girl who's only a couple years older than they are. And I had no memory of that.
Wow.
But I obviously it was read to me and I must have absorbed it. So no wonder I knew it was a kind of
ambivalently
happy ending. Right.
Amazing. All right, let's shift from fiction to something that I think concerns all of us here, which is cities, okay? Mm-hmm. Because a lot of this is about how single women go to the cities and then single women sort of create what it means to be a big, exciting city. Mm-hmm. How does that happen?
Well, everywhere, and this is true, like, as I discovered in medieval Europe, cities draw unmarried women because they offer wages. They offer wages, they offer jobs. So that, you know, in the French countryside, if a lace-making factory opened,
Woo-hoo.
You know, rural women would go to the lace-making factory to earn some wages, perhaps only for a year, but it gave them some measure of, if it's not really economic independence, but as something allowing them to earn money, and also, in many cases, delay marriage. So cities are built, unmarried women flock to them. Cities also provide infrastructure. They provide public there are jobs, there's public transportation, there are smaller living spaces, which especially if you're...
Why is that good?
Well, if you're a woman who's responsible for doing the domestic work of keeping a house, and you're not... smaller living spaces make sense.
Yeah, right.
There is the spirit of community living. I talk to a lot of unmarried women in New York, for example, single mothers who talked about the community watch aspect of being in apartment buildings and having just neighbors out on the sidewalk, someone to help with, you know, watch the kid while they go to bring the groceries, you know, from across the street. And then when you get into more privileged climes in cities, there's food preparation, the stuff that wives were meant to do for no wages, food preparation, services that were part of marriage that women child care in cities, and again, this depends on wealth and privilege, are available as actual financial transactional services in cities, and which makes city life, cities kind of offer a spousal infrastructure
without
to women who don't have wives, right? They've offered it to men too. Men also, single men come to cities and lived in boarding houses and paid for all kinds of services that their wives would have done for free, you know, from house cleaning to prostitution. But cities were really the only place that women could get any kind of equivalent thing. And it took a long time for them to be able to have that.
Can you talk about this one cool hotel that was here. It was the Tromart.
The Tromart, yeah. That was the one that's basically in the meatpacking district.
Tell them about it. I'd never heard of it.
There were a series of hotels. So as women, with the Industrial Revolution, there were new kinds of jobs that began to open up in cities. And women moved from more rural areas to cities to take jobs in mills and factories. And so there was an influx of women, but there was very little place for them to live. And for a long time, they lived in these boarding houses, which were crammed communal houses that often had somebody who was in charge of watching their curfew and
like
making sure they didn't
Brooklyn.
Stay. Yes, exactly. Eventually, as more and more women poured into the city, some real estate entrepreneurs began to think we should build housing for these women. And so there's a series of hotels that grow up in the early 20th century, and they're meant exclusively for single women, and a lot of them have curfews and visiting hours. The Traumart was pretty interesting because it was built especially as a place where women could live while working and where they could be courted. So it was meant to hasten their path to marriage, because here are all these single women living in New York City, but where are they gonna do their courting? Because they don't have sitting rooms, they don't have, their parents aren't there, they can't very well meet out on the street with their men, but here's this inn where they can live, and there'll be public sitting rooms where they can meet their beaus.
Yeah.
And so in an interview, I think with the New York Times, the guy who built the Traumart said he described it as a way station to the altar. But they needed to make the space for that to happen.
You think they could do that now?
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's another really important thing to say about cities and housing. There are a lot of important things to say about unmarried women and housing, because the relationship between cities and single women is so strong that. So I said I'm going to go back to the history of the 20th century because
go back.
So you had this population of unmarried women. People started freaking out about it in the early 20th century. There was a real reaction to it. It wasn't like there, one coordinated person who was like, we're going to institute a pushback against all these unmarried women. But what you got was Teddy Roosevelt beginning to talk about race suicide, where he was talking specifically about how these middle and upper class white women weren't reproducing enough.
Wow.
And that this was dooming the nation. And this was, I mean, it was born out of all kinds of racist rhetoric, also about immigration, and the fact that American immigrants were reproducing at higher rates, and this was going to muddy the American, it was grotesque, right. But that starts, and it's very clearly aimed at these women who are not spending their adulthoods reproducing.
Popping out babies.
There's that, this is around the era that lesbianism becomes identified, singlehood, both sort of become identified by the medical establishment, both in Europe and the United States, as perversions. Lesbianism.
Like being single is a perversion?
Yeah, well, there were doctors who were writing about how celibacy was a sexual perversion. This all started early 20th century. And that if there's a line in the book, from some doctor who wrote about how if the ovaries weren't regularly bathed in semen, would shrivel and die.
That's what happened.
Right.
It wasn't bathing.
Yeah. but all of that joined with, it was also in the early 20th century that lesbianism began to be identified as an identity, as a sort of fixed identity. There had been earlier acceptance and a kind of fluid comprehension that women's relationships with each other, whether they were sexual or not, could be really intimate, really close kind of partnerships, and that didn't define you. It was normal because women were raised in one sphere and totally separate from men. So while sure there were some really great heterosexual partnerships where I'm sure there was a lot of great love and sex or whatever, there was also, it was often very difficult to find real intimacy with somebody who was like from this other
species,
right. They were raised so separately and did such different things. So women did have their most intimate relationships with other women, and that was just sort of considered natural. But in the early 20th century, and it's important to note that the early 20th century is also, a lot of this stuff was sort of right around as the suffrage movement was really finally about to, to produce something, which was the 19th Amendment. And in these years, there begins to be this massive pushback in the press and politically and from the medical establishment against unmarried women. And it was also an encouragement of early hetero mating and dating. So it's in 1914, I think, that the word dating gets coined in the Ladies Home Journal. Wow. Suddenly women who were expected to have their earliest intimate relationships, emotionally intimate, and maybe physically too, with other women, suddenly it was you're supposed to be dating when you're young, men, and this is set up as a goal, like this is part of how you prove your worth. There's a lot of press about how getting married early is really good for you. That push really begins, you know, in the first couple of decades of the 20th century, and of course it only intensifies through after the Depression and the wars. And what I was always taught to understand as the pushback from factory floors, mm-hmm. after World War II that got us into the 1950s, after learning much more about how disruptive the change in marriage patterns had been at the end of the 19th and early 20th century, now understand it as more than just the post-war pushback.
It wasn't just men wanting their jobs back. It was men convincing women that they had to be married.
Well, some women. Oh. So here's a really important part about how we got here, too. Because in that pushback, the post-war pushback, the government went to enormous lengths to push the early married heteronuclear family ideal on white Americans and create a white middle class. And they did that through subsidizing the suburbs, the Levitt towns. These were built exclusively for white residents. These were the new, by investing in infrastructure that, and you know, investing really the GI Bill, right. That white soldiers were
could
able
to
take advantage of, yeah. in ways that returning black soldiers were not permitted to take advantage of. They built the highways that connected the suburbs to the urban centers where there were the jobs.
Yeah.
The government really participated in building and supporting a white middle class that was predicated on the idea that these nuclear families were going to be early married hetero units. And this was a patriarchal family structure that we're very familiar with because it's the vision of the Norman Rockwell 1950s that was so suffocating for white women. A lot of the exact same maneuverings, the building of the highways, for example, were cutting off black families from exactly the kinds of resources, cutting them off from jobs. Black families were excluded from the suburbs that the government was building. Black families, again, black returning servicemen could not take advantage of the GI Bill.
Right.
So the very same mechanisms that were building this white middle class were cutting off African Americans from the resources that could nurture those kinds of nuclear families that were being, and patriarchal marriage models that were being pushed on white women. And at that point, black marriage rates had been higher than white marriage rates after emancipation. During slavery, black marriage was horrifically regulated. It was black marriages
allowed,
were not recognized as legal.
Right.
On the other hand, they were often forced by slave owners on slaves as an attempt to fix families and discourage running away and create more slaves.
Right.
So marriage was a tool, as it is in many circumstances, but during slavery, that was really used to manipulate the slave population. Of course, okay. After emancipation, black marriage rates went very high, and higher than white marriage rates at the end of the 19th century. In the 1950s, black marriage rates, as black families are cut off from these kinds of resources quite deliberately, black marriage rates begin to fall. And you have a rise in single black women and women-headed families. So,
wow.
If you think about it, where does this get us? In 1960, here's the government coming in and moving things around.
mm-hmm.
What comes out of this? In 1963, you have the feminine mystique that explodes out of those patriarchal white suburbs. And in 1965, you have the Moynihan Report, which comes in and assesses black poverty and lays a lot of the blame at the feet of unmarried women and female-headed families. And so that is, I mean, you can see right there the way that singlehood and marriage and government interest in these things all combine. So black marriage rates in the 1960s are low. single black women and single black mothers are blamed for systemic racism and poverty. That's moved through, that becomes the Reagan welfare queen, gets through the 90s to welfare reform. Now, at the same time, a lot of those, the white marriages, and with the feminist movement that arguably comes out of the feminine mystique, although the feminine mystique itself is drawing on so many ideas that actually had been
burbling up.
And actually expressed very directly by a lot of African-American women. I mean, Sadie Alexander was saying the stuff that Betty Friedan was saying in the 1930s about the value of work within marriage and, you know, alongside marriage, the value of work for women. But the feminist movement in the 1970s, you know, in the 1960s and 70s, means a reassessment of a lot of those marriages that were entered into in the mid-century. There's a huge divorce boom. The children of that divorce boom marry less. They begin to say, first of all, there are now conditions created in part by the political movements where now there's Title IX. There's you can get your mortgages. Although now you can do that if you're a married woman as well. But the legalization of birth control, the legalization of abortion, the sexual revolution, the opening up of careers to more women, the opening up of education to more women creates conditions whereby women are no longer dependent in the way that they historically have been. There's also an apprehension after the divorce boom of the 70s and 80s of marriage as an institution of variable quality, right? Like, it's not just a marriage. Like, if your parents were divorced in that giant boom, you maybe can decide that you don't want to enter a bad marriage. And so marriage rates across the board begin to fall. People begin to delay marriage. This is happening over white women then begin to delay marriage. Wow. When white women start delaying marriage, we wind up, and this is true in the history of so much of what we apprehend as liberation.
You have me on the edge of my seat. What happens?
You wind up with Sex in the City.
Ah, I was going to get to Sex in the City.
But then it's the massive acknowledgement of this pattern, which in this case is pioneered in response to economic necessity, as so much is, right?
Wait.
It's pioneered in some ways by black women in the 1950s and 60s. And those women are vilified and talked about as welfare queens and viewed as victims. And then with more privileged women mimic the behavior, it's discernible as liberation and something to celebrate, right? This is true. I mean, this is also true of the whole women working, right? Poor women, women of color have always worked outside the home for wages out of necessity. But when white middle-class women do it in the 1970s, it becomes discernible to us as the women's liberation movement. So this is a pattern that is, that happens with regard to single life too.
Got it. Wow. That was an amazing history lesson. Yay, great. I'm going to ask you one quick pop culture question, and then we're going to open it up to questions.
Is it about Sex in the City? Because I already spoke ill of it. So.
Like, how do we get from That Girl to Sex in the City? I mean, you know, I'm from the That Girl era, so please just discuss That Girl for a minute and satisfy me.
Who here knows what That Girl is?
Oh, God, like three.
All right.
Right. Nobody with dark hair. Okay.
That Girl was a show. I wish I remember.
Marlo Thomas.
It was no. Marlo Thomas part I know. She actually wanted to originally call it Miss Independence. She was a Hollywood. She'd grown up in Hollywood. Her father was a comedian.
This is real life.
This is the 1960s. Right. The woman is named Marlo Thomas. In the 1960s, she's a daughter of Hollywood, and she is going to get her own show. And she reads scripts, and they're all kind of somebody's girlfriend, And she decides. She says, "Why doesn't anybody ever make a show about a woman who's not somebody's wife or not?" And then she hands the network executives the Feminine Mystique, and they give her a sitcom called That Girl, and it's about an unmarried woman who moves into an apartment on her own. She does have a boyfriend.
Donald,
right?
And Donald.
And it's a very, like, it is. I mean, I bought the DVDs and watched them, and I was like, wow. This is a very brightly colored show. I mean, it's very like jewel toned and like, woo, That Girl. It's very cheerful. And
some of us moved to New York, but anyway.
Well, but it was groundbreaking. I mean, now it looks incredibly dated, but it was groundbreaking because it was about a woman. But interestingly, things were changing so swiftly during the time that it was on that Marlo Thomas, who herself then wound up becoming active in the feminist movement, when
Free
they
to
wanted,
be you and me,
right? Yeah, she did Free to Be You and Me. When they wanted to renew it for another season, she said, no, it's no longer realistic because we're not supposed to believe that she and Donald are having sex. And unless you want to let us go there, and they were like, no. She was like, right, we've got to end it. And then they wanted to end it, the executives wanted to end it with them getting married, and she put her foot down and said no. And so the final episode of That Girl was them getting trapped in an elevator, the heroine and her boyfriend, on the way to a women's liberation meeting. And that was the end of That Girl. But at that point, Mary Tyler Moore was sort of then becoming the next and sort of brawnier. It was implied that Mary Tyler Moore, that Mary herself, Mary Richards, was not a virgin, which was a big deal. She worked at a TV studio. So there was, but it was sort of,
right,
these were exceptional. There was a show with Dionne Carroll as a single mother, although she was a widowed single mother, not a never married single mother. That moved into the 80s, Kate and Allie raising children together. Mm-hmm. Murphy Brown, whose single motherhood was so shocking that Dan Quayle talked about it in an election year. That was right about the time. Those early years in the 90s were actually, that's the point that I identify as a really crucial moment as far as single women in the United States, right around the time of the Anita Hill hearings. Anita Hill was an unmarried woman.
You talked to her a lot.
I did talk to Anita Hill a lot. Well, Anita Hill is I think one of the crucial figures in the past 50 years of America's history.
Yeah, no, but it was cool. It's like, it's nice to see her again, and it was clear that they had all these great conversations.
Well, the fact that she was unmarried,
she deliberately is unmarried, it sounds like.
She is now. She's partnered for many years, right. But she's deliberately unmarried. But she was unmarried and unattached at the time of the confirmation hearings. And she actually had written, I was fascinated by this, and when I got to meet her, I thought, oh my God, is she going to be weirded out by the fact that I want to talk to her about her unmarried status? Like, obviously, that's sort of a side issue as to what happened. Yeah. But it turned out she'd already written about it. I'd never seen it, but she wrote a whole essay about how the fact that she, in part, about how she, the fact that she wasn't attached to this institution that made women comprehensible opened her up to so much speculation. And there was the press and certainly the Judiciary Committee treated her like a sexual aberrant. They accused her of having erotomania. There was testimony about how she was lonely and desperate, and this is what motivated her claims against Clarence Thomas.
Disgusting.
And that was all enabled by the fact that she wasn't comprehensible to us as a wife. She wasn't, we couldn't categorize her easily in the way that women, and of course, in the case of Anita Hill, and she also writes about this, race also made her less because she was black, she was less easily categorizable by this all-white, all-male Senate Judiciary Committee and the predominantly white, predominantly male media that was covering her. But that was, there's that, and there's Murphy Brown, and there's all this early 90s panic about unmarried women in politics and in culture. And it turns out, though I don't think people probably knew it at the time, that if you look at the numbers, it was in the early 90s that where there was what they call the great crossover, which is where the average age of gets lower than the average age of first marriage. So it's basically where the lines cross and it becomes normal for women to have children in advance of or outside of marriage. And that was that happened at about exactly the same time as the sort of moral and political panic around single women, whether it's Anita Hill or Murphy Brown.
All right, let's talk panic. Who has a question out there who must get it answered or they're going to explode?
I don't want to. I'm terrible at calling on people. I always get sad.
Right, that'll
when
be,
I make
that'll
the wrong
be my job.
Decision.
I'll do the calling. Right. We're ignoring you and asking you.
Right.
Oh, you get a mic.
Oh.
Wow.
First of all, thank you so much for writing this book. I learned so much. It's amazing. Also, I haven't read your Hillary article yet. I'm going to read
so
it tonight.
Good.
So if that answers my question, just let me know. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about single women in the upcoming election. Mm-hmm. You talk about it in the book, but a lot's happened since then.
Yeah. So single women are a huge factor in the electorate. In 2012, they were 23% of the electorate, so almost a quarter of the electorate, and they voted for Barack Obama over Mitt Romney, By a startling
109-0.
Yeah, pretty much. It was 67-31. Right. But by many measures, because they're such a big part of the electorate and because they vote so consistently Democratic, they vote to the left. So we'll get into Hillary and Bernie in a second. they vote left. And by many measures, it's unmarried women who reelected Barack Obama. Because they were, I mean, this was a consistent, you know, you can slice the electorate in a million ways. But so here's how, there are this time estimated to be more unmarried women in the electorate who might be voting in November than married women.
Wow.
So it is a potentially massive factor. There are challenges. Unmarried women are the most likely to be disenfranchised by voting rights restrictions, especially unmarried mothers, and this is how we get to the policy that really matters, unmarried mothers and women who do not have this government support that makes it possible. They do not have high wages, they do not have childcare, and there are all kinds of things that make it increasingly difficult for them to vote. Secondly, unmarried women are more likely to be mobile. They're more likely to travel, to not be registered, to not have, you know, it's a population that moves around a lot. So getting unmarried women to the polls is something of a challenge from many perspectives. So one of the things that we look at, so you can look at how the candidates do. In the primaries, it varied state by state, but unmarried women who tend to skew young, in many states voted for Bernie over Hillary. Unmarried women of color tended to vote more for Hillary than Bernie. I mean, this was the way that a lot of the, and it depended in terms of age almost more than anything else. But here's the thing. It's going to be, it now certainly will be Hillary, but if it had been either of them, unmarried women want the policies that are being put forth by the Democrat. And that's in part, I write a lot in the book about how the government plays into the current needs of the nation in terms of how we live. Because our social and economic policies, up to this point and still, have been built around the notion and support and reaffirm the notion that this country lives in married, early married hetero units in which there's one kind of person who's doing the earning and one kind of person who's at home doing the domestic work for no money. And that is our everything from our tax laws to the fact that schools get out at 3 o'clock in the afternoon and have giant summer vacations, to the fact that wages have never been protected in female-dominated professions, and that the minimum wage is so low, and 2/3 of minimum wage workers are women, and 1/2 of minimum wage workers are single women, that we do not have mandated paid leave, that we have not had paid sick days legislation until very recently in states and cities. All that stuff has contributed to the forced economic dependence of women on men historically. Now that circumstances have changed and you have more women in the workforce, more women living outside of this organization, out of this institution that had organized gender power, we do not have government supports in place. And that is why the policies that are actually, that were being pushed by both Bernie and Hillary, and it's kind of hilarious because frankly neither of them had much to do with the success of these policies over the past few years. It's the activists and politicians who've really been working on things like paid leave and Fight for 15, paid sick day legislation. That stuff is fundamental to correcting the government's approach to how America is actually living, working, and raising its families. And neither Hillary nor Bernie, I mean, this is people, Barbara Lee and Kirsten Gillibrand, actually, and Elizabeth Warren and Rosa DeLauro, these are the politicians who have been behind a lot of this legislation. And more than that, the activists who've been working for 20 years. I mean, I don't know if you guys remember this, but really, up until 5 or 10 years ago, the notion of paid family leave was like a third rail feminazi thing. And the fact that it's become mainstream enough that I think it's likely to be one of the first things that if there's a, we have a Democratic president, oh God.
I actually think that was Stalin. Just hit.
Stalin. Well, that's there's so many ironies. Is likely to be probably one of the first realistic things that they could take on. So that those kinds of policies that are going to be put forth by the Democratic nominee are things that will disproportionately benefit single women. This is why Republicans like to talk about single women as Beyoncé voters who just want the government to do the job of their husbands and support them, which is true. In fact, I mean, this is something that I talk about a lot. Single women do need to be dependent on the government in the way that white men have been dependent on the government to protect their power, enfranchisement, and participation in the public sphere since the founding. And what all that's happened historically is that women have then been, situations have been created and supported by the government that make women dependent on those men who have been dependent on the government. And now we just need those women to be equally dependent on the government. So that's my, I'm very pro-government dependence.
All right, there was someone over there, yonder. Yes?
What percentage of single women are single by choice or by default?
There's no way to figure it out because it's usually some kind of mix. So, and although I talk to women in the book who are unhappy about being single, who wish that they were married, who want very badly, often not even to be married, but to be in a relationship, to have kids. So, I mean, I write in the book, I interviewed about 100 women around the country who have all different kinds of experiences of singlehood, many of them not clearly in one camp or the other. It's often just a mixed bag. There are a couple of things. First of all, singlehood right now, the growing numbers of unmarried women, are unmarried not because of self-conscious political motivation. Maybe a few are saying, I don't believe in the institution, and therefore I'm not marrying. But it's a teensy, teensy percentage. Most women are not marrying because of a combination of things that they no longer have to, or that, in fact, it no longer makes sense for them to marry someone who could, in fact, be an economic liability or an emotional liability. Because you don't have to be dependent on the husband, the realization that a husband can, in fact, make your life worse means that you don't have to marry.
I'm not
going to
ask for a show of hands.
So it's that they don't have to be, and they haven't found themselves in a circumstance that has led them to want to be. So the question of, is that an active choice or is it circumstance, gets very complicated. It is an active, you know, the good news is that there are so many other things that they can do with their lives without a husband, which also, by the way, it raises the bar on what marriage
can be,
should be, mm-hmm. and what it needs to be in order for women who can now have mm-hmm. other kinds of life mm-hmm. And do lots of the things that they used to only be able to do within a marriage, mm-hmm. They can now do that outside of marriage. Mm-hmm. So it does raise the bar on marriages and make a lot of mates who probably would have been very appealing in earlier eras a lot less appealing now.
Tell them the percent of unmarried women in New York City.
Oh, God, I don't remember the
exact... Well, I do.
Okay, all right, good. I can tell you nationally, but yes.
It's 42. It's 41.7%.
Yeah.
That struck me as enormous. Yeah. Not just struck me as enormous. That is enormous.
Well, the other thing is that between... In the stat I do know off the top of my head is that amongst 18 to 29-year-olds, only 20% of Americans are married, and that's compared to 60% in 1960.
That's just so dramatic. That's just amazing. Person with the glasses there. That's you. Pro glasses here. Yeah.
Hi. So in your book, you chronicle a lot of like kind of different iterations of what singlehood can look like, and also like new models of relationships. And I was like a little bit surprised to not find discussion of like the growing number of folks who are self-identifying as asexual and or like aromantic. Yeah. And I was wondering if that was something that came up in your research at all, something you've been thinking about.
It didn't come up in my research in... It didn't come up in the interviews that I did. It's a very valid critique of what's not in the book. And I've heard it since the book's publication. And in fact, I've written, since I finished the book, I have started work on a story where I wound up talking to a lot of people who self-identify as asexual or aromantic. And I now understand more what a growing... sense of identity this is and how many people are responding to this. But it did not come up either in the interviews that I was doing when I was doing the book or in the in the resources that I was relying on. But I think it's extremely fascinating. I mean, this is part of what, and it's part of, I mean, it's part of the expansion of possibility for women that is what, at the heart of what I'm trying to write about, that it's not just like, oh, there used to be this one path that was early hetero marriage, and now there's this other path that is singlehood. That's not the contrast that I'm trying to draw in this book. It's that once you lift this really confining single model for how female adult life is supposed to proceed, what you get is this infinite variety of paths and also identities and also self-conceptions and ways of approaching the world and all the different facets of life. And I think that asexuality and aromanticism is a fascinating and part of that. And I'm sorry that there's not more of it in the book.
Me too, because I had never heard of aromanticism. It's really interesting. Person in front of the glasses, person. That's you.
Sure. Oh, thank you. Hi, thank you. So I was wondering with the... if your research came across any analysis of the way that women might be a new growing population for accruing debt, mm-hmm. and if the gender sort of asymmetry, considering that they don't come with the foundation, the historic foundation of being able to have their own wealth, and that the mobility that's allowed through things like education, school, but also moving to the city may require a certain amount of taking out credit.
So the realities, and this is one of the reasons that I talk about economic policy as being so crucial to this, economic and social policy, because women are so disadvantaged still in job markets and in housing markets. Interestingly, Anita Hill, I interviewed her for the book about her testimony, but also she now works, she's a law professor at Brandeis, and she writes a lot about housing policy, especially around single women, because housing policy is such a challenge. How do you afford, if you're not married, again, our housing regulations are basically built around the idea, including, and a lot of our housing stock is right. built around the idea that you're in a traditional kind of hetero or partnered family. And women living independently in the world are both spending a lot more money on houses, on cars, on education, than their single male compatriots. But of course, what that means is that they are also going into debt at a faster rate, and they earn lower wages.
Wait,
and
why, especially, why are they spending more on these things than their male counterparts?
Single women buy more houses for themselves, for instance, more homes for themselves than single men, which is interesting. You can mostly just guess at the psychology of that.
I'm guessing, okay.
Yeah. I think part of it is that increasingly single women do see themselves as independent entities in the world and as having adult lives, whereas I do think, and these are about pressures applied to men as well, who don't see their adult lives. I mean, they imagine a home also involves having a wife to fill it and perhaps clean it. But but anyway, that's probably an ungenerous guess. But that's because there is not pay equity, and of course, especially for women of color, the wage gaps are much bigger, and so many single women also are women of color. What you have is this massive debt accrual. I mean, that's one of the issues I didn't mention when we were talking about the presidential election, is the enthusiasm for young women and unmarried women for Bernie Sanders' free college plan. And that was one of the, I mean, I think that's one of the big motivating factors. As women are moving into the world and expecting to, wanting educations, expecting to have careers, and are keenly aware of the debt load that they're taking on, that, I mean, and it's both Sanders and Clinton are dealing with college costs and debt in their campaigns, but Sanders was a more aggressive approach, and I think it appealed to a lot of women for exactly that reason. So, yes, this is one of the reasons that we need things like better protected pay equity. Yes, well, and whatever the approach, whether it's, I mean, you know, Clinton talks about making community colleges free. That had been a plan that had actually been underway for some time that had been, and Sanders wants to do all public universities free. I mean, this is something that must be addressed because, again, you have a growing population that is taking on debt and not earning at an equal capacity, and it is, and that also means not saving for retirement. If there are children, not being able to save for education for children, not being able to invest in housing, or to have anything to pass on. And so all these systems, again, that have historically privileged white men who've been able to accrue wealth and then pass it on, and that all kinds of policy has been made around their ability to accrue wealth, accrue property, you know, earn wages, and then pass that on with as little penalty as possible, women do not have that history. Especially women of color do not have that history, and are now facing increased challenge as they move into the world independently. So, yes, it's a big issue.
In the back? Yeah.
Hi. I haven't read your book yet, but I will soon. And I'm very interested in the topic of health. Were you able to explore the topic of health and single women? Do they, are they a little healthier than married women, or is it the same?
No, that's fascinating. I do write about it in the book. So some of the, there are a lot of arguments against singlehood for women, and most of them are crap. Here's one that's really persuasive. Married women have better outcomes if they get cancer, if they need health care. And there's a lot of people will tell you it's because of like the great emotional strength of partnership. It's probably more about logistical reality. Having somebody to drive you to treatment, having somebody to do childcare. So, and this is one of the really, I mean, this you can't get around this. Married women, married people do better health-wise than never married people. However, you know who does very poorly is divorced women. This is one of the things about, this is one of the asterisks when you talk about the comparative outcomes for single versus married. You will often find, in terms of health, it is that married women have better outcomes than single women health-wise. In terms of wealth and happiness and all this stuff, they're actually often quite equal, but the ones who have the worst outcomes are divorced women, who often take enormous economic hits in divorces. Often women who have entered marriages in which they have given up some of their economic autonomy, and then when the marriage breaks up are left without any kind of economic stability and plunged into debt, often into poverty. And so that has a terrible impact on their ability to get health care, the health care that they need. And this is one of the complications of when you talk about single versus married, married doesn't mean one thing. Married, you know, divorce is a direct symptom, is an outcome of marriage.
But not always.
Right. So yes, I do write about that and sort of explore the complexities there. And also write about the very real, there's a woman who I write about in my book who's in her 70s, who's the among the women I interviewed, the woman who is like the most, like, I could never have been married, marriage is boring, I love being single, my entire life I love being single. She is the most rah-rah single person in the world. But she also talks very movingly about the point at which her mother, when she was taking care of her mother, and her mother was very ill, and her mother said, "Who's going to do this for you?" And that it really hit her. And it's not that she regretted or wanted to be married or partnered, but she was like, this is a real question. Who will do this for me? And she now has kidney disease and is in her 70s. And she talks about this. Her story is in the book at length. And one of the things we need to talk about, and when we talk about housing policy, we also have to talk about healthcare policy and revising, this is tied to housing policy, communal living, retirement communities for women and for men who are living outside of nuclear family units. The other thing in terms of end-of-life healthcare that I write about is that there is this sense that if you marry, you somehow have inoculated yourself against dying alone, which is one of the great myths because...
One of you is going to die alone.
One of you is going to die alone, right. And the other one is, even if in the most happy marriage, the other one is going to live through the passing of the partner. So, yes, I do write about that at some length in the book.
Okay, one last question, and it was the first hand back there, and I've ignored your side, so there you go. Not about death.
Hi. Sorry, I've read about half your book, and bear with me because this is a kind of multifaceted question. I'm really interested in Anita Hill's story. I think it's on multiple levels fascinating, mm-hmm. especially how the media treats her, how the Senate hearings treated her. But in terms of kind of this social deviancy because of a choice to not participate in kind of the traditional ideas of when you are an adult female, she's chastised with what you said, the erotomania and things of that nature. How does that... This gets into kind of something you were talking about earlier about how a social taboo becomes a government maneuvering to correct or what they think of as getting it back on the path that they wanted with nuclear families and things like that. Single women becoming this kind of horrible thing that is erotomania or any like lesbian issues, sapphic issues, things like that with current healthcare policies, specifically with women's wellness and things of that nature, which is a huge issue, both politically, policy, legally, all of those kinds of mm-hmm. nexus of things.
Right. You mean like what is the government doing right now?
Well, I suppose how do you see the
trajectory between
the two?
To push women back into marriage? Because it's doing a lot.
Yes.
Is that what you're asking though?
Or how you see the trajectory between the two of like the social issues that are prevalent for somebody who's like Anita Hill and then how that plays into kind of this governmental, you know, smoke-filled rooms and back corners kind of thing.
Okay. So I think we are in the midst of a lengthy attempt to corral women back into early hetero marriage. And it comes at us, like in the early 20th century, it's coming at us from all angles, silly and very serious, right? So this is everything from the rise of the wedding industrial complex, which has happened coterminously with falling marriage rates, where you're like, oh yeah, no, say yes to the dress. Like, nobody's saying yes to the dress anymore, but like there's this enormously wealthy pop culture mechanism that's telling us that this is the most exciting day of a woman's life, right?
Certainly so there's most expensive.
There's that, yeah, increasingly expensive. Yeah. And so there's that. At the same time that it has become conservative dogma, and you guys have probably heard this, that the cure for poverty is marriage. And this is coming from, I mean, it's so unapologetic. They like are, I mean, I don't know if there are any conservatives or Republicans in this room who want to fight me on this, but it is, I mean, it's in the pages of the Wall Street Journal. It's in, Mitt Romney gave a commencement address right after his, like in 2013, where he told graduates, you know, go out and get married, but don't just get married early. You're missing out on so much of life if you don't marry early. In the debate between Obama and Romney, I was writing this book while this happened, and I was like, I had to like scrape my jaw off the floor, because there was, in one of the debates in 2012, the moderator asked a question about how do you stem the tide of gun violence, and Mitt Romney totally answered that you should tell women to marry someone. Right? This is, that was the for real answer that he gave. But this is, it's conservative dogma to blame every ill on the dissolution of the family, which, by the way, footnote, is single women's fault. So there's that larger argument. Conservatives talk about the success sequence, which is graduating from school, getting married, having a kid. This is how we get. The Bush administration and then the Barack Obama administration poured hundreds of millions of dollars into marriage initiative projects, educating marriage, pushing marriage through churches, through marriage education projects. You know, this is, there are government manipulation at work. And then there is the actual policy stuff. So I talked about what's going on the Democratic side. If you look at the stuff that Republicans are obsessed with, making abortion illegal and making contraception harder to get, disenfranchising people who are most likely to be women and people of color, not mandating paid leave, not mandating pay protections, those are all mechanisms that if they went through, if Donald Trump or the player to be named later who could replace him ever became president in 2016 and had a Supreme Court to stack and had a Congress behind him, we could be returned very quickly to a world in which women are economically dependent on men, because all of this stuff is manipulatable by the government. And that is exactly at the heart of what restricting reproductive liberty is about. When you take away from women, and it's not, it's about abortion, it's about birth control, it is about their ability to earn equally. When you take those things away from women, they cannot live independently in the world, and they, again, will be forced to be dependent on the kind of people who can live independently in the world.
Well, that's where we end. My God. That's a rousing cry.
Vote in November.
Thank you. Really great.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.